Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to Silver Lake United Methodist Church. My name is Alex Rosso, and I am the pastor of this wonderful community. You might be thinking, I mean, every summer, right? We have to have a time where we do VBS, and this past week, it was super fun. We did it Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. A lot of you volunteered for it. We had a good group of kiddos, and we just had a lot of fun experiencing and talking about a God who loves us, and they had adventures. As you see right here, you can see the adventures they went on. They went around and they looked for like the belt of truth, the shield of faith, and they went all around the 3 days experiencing those things. They made those things. They made a shield. They made lots of other things, but then they did recreation. They danced. They sung. And it's just a great time. I always love VBS. And then at the end, I got an ice cold shower. And it's fun. It's fun. But I really love it. This year, I'm grateful to have it. Like we always take things for granted. And VBS was one of the things I always took for granted. And then last year, we weren't able to have it. But this year, we were able to have it. And we were able to have a lot of fun. And it just made me extremely grateful for just all these things that we take for granted, and then we're able to do them and experience them, not just as ourselves, but as a community together. And it was super fun. And I just want to thank Kimberlynn, and then all the people who volunteered for it. It was just an amazing time. And so thank you, Kimberlynn. I thank you. I know Tara and Kylie helped. Thank you, Andy, who helped. I'm looking around. I might forget. Sarah Thomas helped. Peg Howard helped. Kathy helped. Yeah, just thank you for everyone that helped out and made it a great time for the kiddos. And so later on in worship today, the kids who are here today are going to share a couple of their songs with you. And I want to encourage you to sing along if you want to stand up with them and dance with them. I want to see your dance moves too, not just their dance moves. I mean, the word that you'll see the dance moves on the screen, so you can follow along and dance with them. I just want to encourage you to have fun with them, and it's a way for you to experience VBS like they did when you participate in the songs that they sung. And I want to say happy birthday to Doris Robertson. Her birthday's August 3rd. And then Bruce Thomas, his birthday is this week, August 6th, right? Yeah. Are there any other birthdays or anniversaries you'd like to celebrate with us? All right, let's stand together for the gathering hymn, I Love You, Lord. Please join me in the gathering words. Praise the Lord. Ooh. Oh, please join me in the call to worship. See, this is why we need you to lead worship with me. You see, even I can make mistakes, so if you make a mistake here and there, it's welcome, okay? Please join me in the call to worship. By this I have known the presence of the Lord in the rising of the sun, in the smile of another's face, in the touch of a hand or the sound of a laugh, in the scent of a flower holding the promise of spring. By this I have known the power of the Lord in the healing of hurts, in the forgiveness of sin, in the giving of gifts beyond all expectation, in the shower of love that comes from God's Son. Let us give thanks to the Lord with all our heart. Let us worship our God, whose presence and power endures forever. Let's continue to worship by singing, His name is wonderful. And now you can sit down, and the kids who want to participate in the VBS singing and dancing can come forward, and they're going to share a couple of their songs. Yes, that's you, Lydia. I can go grab Claire and Miriam. And so if you want to come up and get situated so you can dance together. Dayton and Talon, are you going to show your dance skills?
No.
Okay. I'm going to go grab Miriam and Claire. Hey, Mimi, Claire, and Ryan, you want to dance? Show. If you want to stand up and get ready to dance with them, you can. Would we like to wait a second, or is it good? Yeah. Fingers crossed. You are being so patient. Everyone is. Here we go.
Follow, sweep and give it all we
Yay, thank you. Thank you for sharing. I know it's super hard to share dance moves and singing in front of a group of people, right?
They seem to be more excited on 3 days. So.
Yes, absolutely. When you're in front of people, the pressure mounts. And so thank you. Will you please stand again as we say the gathering words together from Psalm 111. Praise the Lord. I thank the Lord with all my heart. The works of the Lord are magnificent. They are treasured by all who desire them. God's deeds are majestic and glorious. God's righteousness stands forever. God is famous for his wondrous works. The Lord is full of mercy and compassion. God gives food to those who honor him. God remembers his covenant forever. God proclaimed his powerful deeds to his people and gave them what had been belonged to them, other nations. God's handiwork is honesty and justice. All God's rules are trustworthy. They are established always and forever. They are fulfilled with truth and right doing. God sent redemption for his people. God commanded that his covenant lasts forever. Holy and awesome is God's name. Let's continue to worship by singing the hymn, Be Thou My Vision. Amen. You may be seated as we say the unison prayer together. Almighty God, fount of all wisdom, crown of all knowledge, give us eyes to see and minds to understand your marvelous works, that we may know you through your handiwork and use your creations to your glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And so we want to pause and we want to offer up a moment where we surround each other in prayer. And so if you have a joy that you'd like to share with us, if you have a concern that you'd like for us to surround in prayer, I invite you to share with our community now. Carolyn. Congratulations, Carolyn and Jack. And so for those of us worshiping with us online, Carolyn and Jack have a new granddaughter. It was born in Fayetteville, Arkansas, and her name is Henley June Steele, and the parents are Kyle and Jessica, right?
Right.
Perfect. Are there any other prayer requests or joys that you'd like to share with our community? I have one. I know next Saturday, someone in our community is going to be on their last deployment, and he is standing right, he's looking at me right now. Joe is going on his last deployment, and it's been on my heart a long time. I've known it for at least a month or so, and I was like, I just want to surround Joe in prayer, not only as he leaves his family for, how many months is it? 2 months. I can't imagine how hard that might be, but then also a career transition that Joe is having. And so I've been thinking about what to do, and I've landed on this. And so Joe, you can pinch me later or do whatever you want to later. What I'd like for us to do for Joe is to like extend our arms to Joe and just surround him in prayer. But as you're praying for Joe, also to remember Sarah, Carly, and Jackson, as he'll be gone for a couple months, and so remember to surround them in your prayers too. And so will you please join me in praying for Joe and Sarah, Carly, and Jackson. God, we lift up Joe to you now today. We know in a week, less than a week, he'll be going on his last deployment. And we ask that you surround him in his travels, to grant him traveling mercies as he travels to Guam, but also to make your presence abundantly known to him, to open up the channels of communication between Joe, Sarah, Carly, and Jackson, so they may still feel the love from one another, the encouragement of one another, and the support of one another. I ask that you bless and keep Joe while he is in Guam, and you bless and keep Carly, Jackson, and Sarah while they are here in Silver Lake. And may we be a community who surrounds them and supports them and encourages them in the next 2 months. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Are there any other joys or concerns that you might want to share with our community? All right, please join me in prayer. Oh God, we give thanks for a new birth and people being born and to celebrate that, to come alongside the Steels as they celebrate the birth of their grandson. God, we thank you for new creation. And God, as we turn to the Psalms today, may we see that the psalmist knew that they were also a new creation because of God's mercy and God's forgiveness. Our hope, God, today is that you surround each and every one of us with your presence, letting us know that there is nothing we can do to separate us from your love. And we give you thanks for that. God, we pray for the leaders of the world and the leaders of our community, that you continue to guide and lead them in their discernment processes as they navigate the way forward for their respective countries, for our country and for our community. We ask that you be present with them as they make the important decisions that they make. God, we know in this next coming week, teachers and support staff will be going back to school to prepare for the coming school year. God, and we ask that you surround the teachers, support staff, and everyone who is working at the schools. We ask that you surround them with your presence. Surround them as they navigate the new school year and continue to put the final touches on their plan for the school year. We ask that you bless them and keep them. God, we know there are some of us who are in assisted living facilities, who are trying and doing all the exercises that the therapist might be teaching us to do. We ask that you continue to guide and lead them and strengthen them as they do these practices and exercises so they may return home to their loved ones. God, we know that some in our community are experiencing health challenges. And we ask that you work through the medical professionals that are providing care to them to restore them to health. God, we pause in this moment to lift up our own joys and concerns that are on our own hearts, but were not spoken to the community. God, we give you thanks for being the great listener, the one who hears the cries of our hearts, the shouts of joy that are in our hearts that encourages us and supports us. For that, we give you thanks. God, we pray all of these things in the same way that Jesus taught his disciples to pray and continues to teach us to pray by praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I ask you to stand for the reading from the 130th Psalm. And so this is the last Sunday of the summer in the Psalms. Please join along in this reading. I cry out to you from the depths, Lord. My Lord, listen to my voice. Let your ears pay close attention to my request for mercy. If you kept track of sins, Lord, my Lord, who would stand a chance? But forgiveness is with you. That's why you are honored. I hope, Lord, my whole being hopes, and I wait for God's promise. My whole being waits for my Lord, more than the night watch waits for morning. Yes, more than the night watch waits for morning. Israel, wait for the Lord, because faithful love is with the Lord, because great redemption is with our God. He is the one who will redeem Israel from all its sin. May God add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and understanding of God's word. Amen. And if there's any preschool to second graders, they can go to the nursery with Miss Gina for Sunday school, and the rest of you may be seated. So we've been in the Psalms for four or five Sundays, and does anybody remember, there's no like extra credit here, but does anybody remember like what one of the things we might have talked about, a characteristic of God that the psalmist knew? They knew God was always present with them, that God was always with them. They knew God as a creator. And God is a creator, so we are meant to create. And so we glorify God when we create things. And we talked about it as a community. You all shouted out what you help create with your hands. We learned that God is always willing to lead us. God is always willing to guide us. And God is always willing to reveal God's will to us. And then the psalmist today, on top of those things, and so you can tell that they had a deep relationship with God if they knew God's characteristics as each one of those things. And so today we're going to learn about how they knew God as being merciful and forgiving. And so what I know about forgiveness and mercy is they're very closely linked, right? And when we forgive someone, I know as hard as it is sometimes, it tends to move us as the ones who forgive to a better place, right? Not so much the person that is forgiven, sometimes they can continue on, but for the person who forgives, it often moves you to a better place. But we often don't forgive people, right? We hold on to things. We talked about that a little bit last week, about our tendency to hold on to things. And so think of yourself as having a backpack. And each time you hold on to something or you don't forgive something, you put a rock in that backpack. And then, you know, a month later, you hold on to another thing and you don't forgive and you put another rock in the backpack. Is it getting heavier or lighter? Heavier, right? And so each time you don't forgive or you're unable to let that go out from you, it's going to just continue to add up. And then all of a sudden, I've seen where we keep on collecting these rocks because we're holding on to them and we're not always ready to forgive. And then all of a sudden, we become come to a place where we might be strapped to the ground, the weight might be too much, and we collapse and we begin to take it out on others. And so forgiveness, and sometimes it takes to do a small rock. You can't always go straight to the big rocks, but to the small rocks, and to forgive those, remove some of the weight from your backpack. But we have to know that's our tendency. But I'm gonna go ahead and guess, because the psalmists were human beings just like each and every one of us, right? So what did they do when they talked about God, or how did they perceive God as merciful and forgiving? How did that help them take the rocks out of their backpack so they could let go of them, to forgive someone and ultimately move to a better place? We have to know what the words mercy and forgiveness mean, right? Does anyone want to take a guess on what the word mercy means or what forgiveness means? No guesses? All right. I guess I can tell you. So if we look at Merriam-Webster dictionary, mercy is defined as compassion shown to someone who they use the word offender, or someone that might do wrong to you, but it's subject to one's power over another. So mercy is, you can extend mercy to someone that you might have power. And if you're struggling with that definition, how I was struggling with it, if you're a parent and your kid does something and you're like, oh my gosh, like you can still extend mercy to them. Delay, like how you might punish them. You might not make it as bad. You might not punish them at all. You might like explain what they did and the effects that it had on their friend or a family member. So mercy is something that is given to someone without an expectation of being repaid or anything like that. It is a It goes beyond just like being nice to one another, right? It is deeper than being just nice to one another. And so in the storyline of our faith, we can see how God's mercy is extended to us, right? We can look at how the pattern seems to be, like God does this good work, and then we somehow mess it up, or we fail to some degree, and then it's followed up by God's mercy and forgiving all of us again. And so it just is this continuing story that we see woven throughout Scripture. And so it's always God's mercy that provides a new way, a new pathway that often we are unable to see. And so you think about it like the story from the very beginning of the Bible, Adam and Eve, how they were in the garden and they failed to be faithful to God. And so yet God's mercy allowed them to continue to live and to continue to prosper, but they weren't expecting that. Even out of the garden, they continued to live and continued to prosper. And then we see that in like how the Israelites were in Egypt and they were in the wilderness, and they were complaining and groaning against God. Get us out of here. We don't belong here. How are you gonna do it? They said they'd rather be back in Egypt while they were wandering in the wilderness back in Egypt, back in slavery, rather than being where they were. This one grumble after another as they're wandering in the wilderness. And here it is, God shows mercy and provides manna for them to eat along their journey to freedom, to sustain them, leading them to the promised land. And so we see this time and time and again. And I think we can insert our names when the Bible uses Israel sometimes, right? And so instead of like God's people Israel lacked faithfulness, God's person Alex lacked faithfulness, and yet God continued to provide for Alex. You can insert your name in there because normally you say God's people, the Israelites, lacked faithfulness, and yet God continued to provide for them. Insert your name in there. But the truth is, in all of these stories, that God remained steadfast in the covenant that he made with humanity each and every time. And so we see that in the psalm, that the psalmist, that they knew this. And so we see in Psalm 131 how they cry out for God's mercy. And so listen to these words from Psalm 130. I cry out to you from the depths, Lord. My Lord, listen to my voice. Let your ears pay close attention for my request for mercy. If you kept track of sins, Lord, my Lord, who would stand a chance? But forgiveness is with you. That's why you are honored. I hope, Lord, my whole being hopes. And I wait for God's promise. My whole being waits for the Lord. More than the night watch waits for the morning. Yes, more than the night watch waits for the morning. Israel, wait for the Lord. Because faithful love is with the Lord. Because great redemption is with our God. He is the one who redeemed Israel from all of its sin. And then later in Psalm 51, we hear the psalmist's same cry for mercy. The psalmist cries, create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new spirit within me. You have to remember that the, most of the psalms were written by David, right? A pretty flawed individual. But here he is crying out over and over again for God's mercy. And he I think David is crying out for God's mercy because it is not offered because we have earned it or given to us because we've given God anything. It is freely given to us. God's grace is not granted because of anything we have done to receive it or deserve it. It is given because it is the nature of God to be merciful to each and every one of us. And see, so mercy is the faithfulness of God to show compassion to us. God's created. When we time and time again mess up or miss the marks, God sends us mercy. God sends us mercy. And so mercy, is the psalmist knew that this mercy would create in them a new path forward, a new hope, a new life, another chance. But it was also at giving them support and strength. Listen to this in Psalm 111. I thank the Lord with all my heart. The works of the Lord are magnificent. They are treasured by all who desire them. God's deeds are majestic and glorious. God's righteousness stands forever. God is famous for his wondrous works. The Lord is full of mercy and compassion. God gives food to those who honor him. God remembers his covenant forever. God proclaimed his powerful deeds to his people and gave them what had belonged to other nations. God's handiwork is honesty and justice. All God's rules are trustworthy. They are established always and forever. They're fulfilled with truth and right doing. God sent redemption for his people. God commanded that his covenant last forever. Holy and awesome is God's name. So Psalm 111 is a praise to God for God's mercy. But then also in Psalm 111, we begin to understand how mercy and forgiveness are linked. And so we often hear in society, I heard it this past week, is that someone said to me, someone had to earn their forgiveness. Have you ever heard that? Like, you have to do something to earn my forgiveness. Has anybody heard that? Or maybe you've even said it, right? But I don't think this measures up to the narrative in the gospel message. You see, God, through Christ, forgave us without any evidence that we were seeking forgiveness. Without any evidence, Christ forgave us. We didn't say anything. We didn't do anything. It was before us. Forgiveness without any evidence. That's crazy, right? For us as humans, that sounds crazy, right? Because we want the evidence that something has changed before we often forgive people, right? But the story of the gospel is that we are forgiven and we don't need to provide evidence to be forgiven. You see, the disciples were told to forgive an uncomfortable number of people, they thought. When the Sadducees and the Pharisees asked who our neighbor is, Jesus replied with the parable of the Good Samaritan to show how we must not only love ourselves, but to love our neighbors as ourselves. We are to concentrate on what we can do and not think about what someone else should do or might do or could do. We're supposed to concentrate on what we can do. But we have a tendency to waste time and effort on the shortcomings or the wrong deeds of others rather than focusing on what we as individuals can do. We see what people do wrong more clearly than we see what we do wrong. And so listen to this from Psalm 32. When I kept quiet, my bones wore out. I was groaning all day long, every day, every night, because your hand was heavy upon me. My energy was sapped as if it was a summer drought. Selah. So I admitted my wrongdoings to you. I didn't conceal my guilt. I confessed my sins to the Lord. It is what I said. Then you removed the guilt of my sins. Selah. And so remember, they're pausing. When you hear the word Selah, they're pausing and reflecting in there. And so they're seeing, like, when I remained quiet and didn't forgive or extend mercy, it doesn't say that they had a lot of rocks in a backpack. What does it say? It says, when I kept quiet, my bones wore out. I imagine Alan and Francis and Bruce out in the field this past week when it was so hot, and I imagine that sometimes they might have felt like, oh my gosh, my bones are worn out. Like that's how the psalmist felt. But my bones are worn out. And so what does it look like to forgive or extend mercy like we see in the Psalms and in the New Testament? I ran across this story that this person thought someone was playing a cruel joke on them. They had been in and out of the hospital for a couple months. They had multiple surgeries over a period of 2 or 3 years, so their medical debt had been accumulating and rising, so much to the point where they were homeless because they couldn't pay their medical debt that they owed. And then one day in the mail, they received a letter, and it said, "This portion of your medical debt has been forgiven." And so she thought it was a scam. And so she called and was trying to figure out, is this real? Is this real? And she got a hold of the hospital, and she heard that it was true. And so she was excited for joy, but then she realized, I didn't do anything to have this medical debt forgiven. But it was a non-profit medical debt company who had bought up all these debts and specifically chosen people who were below a certain income level and went in, that so they were unable to pay off their medical debt, and selected her as a recipient. And so they called the hospital, negotiated with the hospital. And so when she received it, she knew that she had done nothing to receive it, because you can't apply for it. A company, a nonprofit, goes out and seeks this all on their own. And she said that this was something that someone did for me when they didn't know me, out of the kindness of their heart. And so the money that they gave represented a small fraction of what she owed. But she says the forgiveness that she experienced, forgiveness is of the amount you owe, was a no strings attached gift from someone. I think that is what forgiveness looks like. That is what mercy looks like, a no strings gift to someone else. That's what the gospel says mercy and forgiveness is. I think if we look at the story of Paul, we see in Romans 8:28 that nothing can separate us from the love of God. And Paul's story, as someone who went and persecuted Christians, to being a great advocate for Christianity, we can see the new creation that forgiveness can give to ourselves and to other people. It can radically change someone's life. It can change their perspective to know that they are forgiven, we are forgiven, we are accepted, and we are redeemed always by God's grace. Would you please pray with me? Oh God, may we come to know that mercy and forgiveness that you offer and freely give to each and every one of us is a no strings attached gift. May we encounter your mercy and forgiveness in the areas of our lives where we need to experience your mercy and forgiveness, so that we can also share it with one another and others in our community and today and in the days and week ahead. We ask you that you bless us and keep us in this coming week, so that we can extend your mercy and forgiveness to other people, including ourselves. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Will you please join in singing the hymn of response, Because He Lives? And now we're going to come to God's table and celebrate Holy Communion together. As we do this, I want to a couple options for you all. There is what we have normally done with the elements over here, but then there's also there's prepackaged communion elements too. And so I want you each to be comfortable as you receive communion, so you are welcome to either. Another thing is that everyone is welcome. Everyone can come and sit at God's table. You don't have to be a member here. All you have to do is be willing to receive God's love that God has for each and every person, and undoubtedly each and every person in this room. We are going to do the communion liturgy from the hymnal, and so it's on page 13, so you should have a hymnal in front of you if you would like to follow along. You can even join along. We're going to start on page 13 with the Great Thanksgiving, and so I'll give you a couple moments so we can join along together. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat this. Every time you eat of this, remember me. Do this in remembrance of me." And so when the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. God, pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by God's blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And so I invite you, as you come forward, we'll be standing and invite those that are helping with us to come forward. And if as you come forward, I invite you to come to whichever station you would like to receive communion as the row in front of you comes up. Will you please rise as we sing the doxology? Seeing the closing hymn, I wanted to, have you looked in your bulletin? If you grabbed one, did you look in your bulletin? I just want to point out a couple things that are on there. And so starting next Sunday, the youth group is going to gather. We don't know that it's to be determined based on what movie times the theater are showing. And so I think it'll probably be a little bit before 4, and then we're going to go to the movies and watch a movie. But beforehand, for the parents, we're going to meet beforehand. Also, we'll send an email out to you. We're going to meet beforehand because we're going to discuss the mission trip that and try to say this week might work next summer. I know it's a long time away. This week might work in June, or this week might work in July. Try to get it as close as we can, because they've decided they wanted to go to, I'm not French, so I might really butcher. I took Spanish in high school. I did not take French. And I think it's Bayou La Batar in Alabama. I think I might have said that close, but that's where they have they researched and decided that they wanted to go. I think partly because it's really close to the Gulf, so they'll be really close to the beach, and they want a beach day. But I was like, it's also going to be June or July in Alabama, so it's going to be. Do you think Kansas is hot and humid? It might be really hot and humid down there. So that's the plan. And so you'll see the first one is also August 18th. So. In about 2.5 weeks, they're going to be doing a barbecue dinner fundraiser. As of right now, we're going to have to dine here. You can dine here at the church. You can order carry out. You can order delivery, whatever you are comfortable with. And we just want to invite you to come and support the youth group. Or if you just want a meal, come and have a meal. Whatever you would like to do. Then this next week is the last week for lunches. Monday, Wednesday, and Friday will be the last week, because the week after that, the kids will be back in school. Then produce boxes. This Wednesday, August 4th, will be the last produce box distribution. And I'm a numbers guy, so... I tried to put into capture, like, what amount of food and dairy products has came through and in and out of the doors of the church. And so it's been over 700 gallons of milk and over 36,000 pounds of produce and food. Just from, we started last June, so just over a year of doing it every other week. That's roughly the amount of food that has come in and out through the church to our community. That's a lot. That's a lot of food. That's 18 tons of food. And I wish I had a diagram that could stack it up and to show you, like, how big is 18 tons of food? Would it fit in the sanctuary if we could stack it up? But that's a lot. And that's because of you all and you all supporting that mission and the people who have organized it and delivered it and carried it out through the community. That's because of you all and your support. And so thank you for that. Will you please hear the let's sing the closing hymn. I was about to give the benediction and leave. Let's sing the closing hymn together. Shalom to you. Benediction for this week is on your screen. Will you please join me in saying it? Today, O God, we have turned to you in search of direction for our lives, and you did not turn us away. You have opened our ears to your word, our eyes to your purpose, and our hearts to your presence. Now send us forth as people who hear with their ears, see with their eyes, and understand with their hearts, that your word might bear fruit within us and through us. And may you experience God's mercy and forgiveness in new ways this week. And may God bless you and keep you. Amen.